Aside from a ship, the most likely place you'd imagine to meet a pirate was probably in a tavern. Much like today, people wanted somewhere to go to socialize and have a few drinks after they got paid. And much like today, the owners of these establishments provided a welcoming atmosphere to bring the customers in. The tavern, which derives from the Latin word tabernia meaning shop, was a place where a person could get a drink, eat a meal, and rent a room. In addition, taverns served as meeting halls, post offices, and convenience stores. These establishments were very popular and profitable. Before the Great Earthquake of 1690, Port Royal, Jamaica was reported to have had one tavern for every two houses. A good tavern would have had a sitting area, a bar, a place for dancing, several rooms upstairs, and even a stable to look after a customer's horse if he had one. The walls in these places were covered with notices for sales, reward posters for escaped slaves and indentured servants, and notices of trials and hangings. There were also broadsheets posted on the walls as well. Broadsheets were the way music was spread in the age, and were printed lyric sheets, usually set to the music of popular tunes. As there was no way to record music, the lyrics were printed and then sold door to door. If the owner of a tavern liked the music, he would pay a small fee and the sheet was attached to the wall. A large tavern might have offered an in-house musician that would play popular tunes while the patrons sang out lyrics right off of the broadsheets, almost like a karaoke bar full of drunken pirates. In other places, the crowd may have sang without the music. Taverns also served as the workplaces of local prostitutes. It was reported that sailors, quote, spent money like rainwater, and a pirate could make as much as the average sailor made in a year after being out for just a few weeks. These men tended to spend the money they made just as quickly, and the prostitutes and tavern owners both were happy to have them. That's not to say a room of drunken pirates didn't have problems from time to time, and it's likely these men were very loud. In contrast to the average law-abiding sailor, a pirate would have no problem with fighting, theft, or robbery. They also would have let the staff know if the service wasn't to their liking, or if they wanted the music changed. On land, pirates had followers comparable to fans today. These people were obsessed with the stories pirates told, as well as the slight hint of danger that came from being associated with them. In some cases, these followers were well off and willing to buy drinks for the pirates, and, in other cases, were interested primarily in the pirates buying them drinks, or trying to sell them things they may have wanted. In a small town where not much was happening, it would have been big news to hang out and listen to the sea stories coming from these men who were, in some cases, infamous to the point of celebrity. Aside from their companions, pirates would have also met with society's upper class in taverns to discuss business. These rich men, some of whom had made a fortune from dealing with pirates, would not and could not associate with them out in the open, so a corner of a dimly lit tavern would have been the go-to location. These were not only merchants, corrupt political figures kept pirates close as well. Charles Eden, the governor of North Carolina, was known for his connections with Stede Bonnet and Edward Blackbeard Thatch. In any case, during these meetings, the pirates would have been drinking quite a bit, as well as eating whatever the tavern served. During the time period, it's likely chicken, beef, eggs, soups, and fish would have been on the menu in most coastal taverns, but some would have served better food than others. I should point out that the food would taste very bland to us today, as the average person could not afford spices. One of the many things pirates loved to steal were spices like cinnamon, pepper, nutmeg, cloves, allspice, and ginger, and it was reported that pirates loved spice food. It's very possible that some of these spices were sold to cooks in these taverns, or used on demand by a pirate eating his meal. As far as the drink selection, besides ale, a tavern most often always had a selection of wines, whiskey, and rum.
I prefer rum. Rum's good.
This brings us to the difference between taverns and pubs. Taverns were purpose-built for the job, while a pub, which is short for public house, was not. Many homes saved money and brewed ale or beer at home. A big reason was to kill bacteria in water and also help with the taste. Brewing is both an art and a science, and if a brewer had a good recipe that not only tasted good but also got you pretty drunk, it would make sense to sell it to help with the bills. These brewers would then make their private houses public by putting out a sign inviting others in to buy drinks. Pirates may have felt safer in pubs depending on where they were and how much profile they had. For example, if you're a wanted man with a sizable price on your head, you might think twice about getting drunk in a busy tavern on the main road. A small pub a few streets back would be a safer bet. A pirate, or any customer, would go into the pub, sit down at the dining room table with the family, and then agree on a price for a drink. The husband and wife would make conversation and, at the end of the night, if the pirate was too drunk, he could stay in a spare room for an additional fee. I'm sure in some cases the wife was not too happy with her husband for allowing some of these men into their homes. But in a time with such low wages, it'd be hard to resist welcoming men who spent so much, so fast, in for a few beers.